Very good afternoon and welcome back. Post-lunch session, the challenge is to keep ourselves awake, both you guys and on the stage, these five gentlemen. As the compere said, the subject is, can private banks take the Indian economy to the next orbit? Now, why are we saying this, that everything, the onus is on private banks? They have become the new atlas on whose shoulder Indian economy rests, because those who are you, I think most of you were there in the previous discussion, previous panel, the public sector banks are losing their market share incrementally very fast, and in the stock wise slowly. I'm just repeating the same certain numbers. 1990s, their share was 90%, 2000, 80%, 2015, around 75%, 2018, 61%. That's on the stock. And incrementally, I'm repeating, on the assets, 2014, their incremental asset share was 72%, which came down to 9.5% in 2019. Similarly, for deposits, 76% in 2014 came down to 20.48% in 2019. So clearly, public sector banks are losing their market share. There have been experiments, consolidation we spoke about, privatization is being planned, etc. So these gentlemen represent private sector, which is both private and foreign banks, and all of them are in the news for something or other. Amitabh Chaudhary, Axis Bank, your stock is just hit all-time high yesterday, right? And he is taking over the retail business of Citi. Mr. Dave, HSBC, very aggressive, and you can see the subtle ads that your city is everywhere, et cetera, et cetera. So he wants to catch the retail segment of city's thing and grab it, not saying it in as many words, but you look at the underlying messages of the HSBC ads, and very aggressively he is going. Ashok Koller at the middle, again, it's a global decision. India is one of the many markets. They'll focus primarily and hugely on corporate segment. Retail, no more. This gentleman, IDBI, in the news for quite some time, and now, obviously, because finally the privatization process is taking shape. There was a bit of, sir, allow me to say, mock privatization, LIC ko de diya, privatization bol rahe the, but now real privatization is happening. And on my left is Vaidyanathan, IDFC Bank. He's a very different kind of bank. The type of assets he's experimenting with and getting into are very different from the rest of the pack. So they're all five unique gentlemen representing five unique institutions which are in the news. Thank you all for coming. We have 1 hour time, out of which about 8 minutes we have already covered. So 52 minutes, we'll take one or two or three questions in between, not at the end. And I'll not speak much from now on. My job is just to facilitate thing and all. So have a preliminary remarks. Is the right way to discuss that making India a 5 trillion economy, it's already become the fifth largest economy, overtaking UK. It's now public sector banks are still in the sort of mode of experimenting how it will move forward, etc. But it's the private banks, that's the responsibility. And I'll not take the numbers because it will take time. If you look at the growth in advances, etc., you are far ahead than them. And also the quality of assets, which is an indicator, is the non-performing assets. All you guys have been relatively lower than your counterparts in the public sector banks. So all these things put you in the center stage. No offense intended to the government-owned banks, but you have a huge responsibility to take India to the next level. You have the right kind of talent in your bag, because you can give market-related salary. You are not subject to the three Cs, the CVC, CBI, and others. And you are board-driven. The DFS does not come in the picture, which we were discussing earlier. So tell us, preliminary remark, then we'll get into the thing and all. We'll start with from you, and this way, Amitabh, over to you, sir.
So firstly, thank you, Tawal, for inviting us to this panel. Sincerely appreciate it. I do want to state, Hitendra is a good friend. remains a very good friend, in spite of the ads. You're absolutely right that as we head towards a $5 trillion economy, the banking industry and broadly the financial services industry has a very important role to play in supporting this growth which the government expects to deliver within a defined time period. You also pointed out that the public sector banks are losing market share, but that does not mean that they're not growing. They're just growing at a slow pace than maybe what the private sector and the foreign banks have been able to deliver consistently over a period of time. I think we have had the luxury to pick up our markets, our customer segments, our products, and build them up and create decent market share in each of those categories over a period of time. But as we drive towards this 5 trillion number, it is very, very obvious that all of us have to literally play in almost every customer segment in almost every part of the country to make a big impact and continue to gain market share. It's not that the public sector banks are just sitting and waiting for us to take the market share. They become aggressive. I think if you look at the numbers in the last 6 to 8 months, they're back in the market, especially on the wholesale side. We see them increasingly being aggressive even on the mortgage space. So they are slowly, gradually coming back. Some of the public sector banks have been very aggressive from the very beginning, SBI being one of them, followed by Bank of Baroda. So I would say that both have to play a role. I think the private sector banks can do much more, and they are, as you see more data being shared, as some of the government platforms becoming more ubiquitous, as more and more data is becoming available, it will become easier for all of us to extend our capabilities and our reach into some of the markets we've not been present in. And you will see, hopefully, that while the public sector banks continue to get more aggressive, the private sector banks, my belief is, will continue to gain market share slowly, gradually, over a period of time, because now we are going to some of the areas where our presence was limited. Basically, by that, I mean the semi-urban and the rural markets of the country. We are also going down the risk curve a little bit. We are now willing to bank more and more customers. I mean, half of India is still underserved in terms of credit. So as underwriting standards improve, data improves, algorithms improve, I think we can underwrite more and more of India. And I think all of us are running projects to underwrite more and more of India, which means that our presence in those markets will also improve. So I'm looking forward to this renewed competition to support the Indian economy, the renewed competition between us and the public sector banks and the NBFCs, who are also getting better and better at what they do over a period of time. So you have a couple of NBFCs who are doing stuff which some of the banks have not been able to achieve. So I think the intense competition will drive all of us in the right direction, and that's what all of us are looking forward to as we move forward.
Thank you. Mr. Dave.
Yeah, no, I think to supplement the comments that Amitabh made, I think it's a great time to be in the business of banking or in the financial services space, because the pie, frankly, is growing for everyone. As Amitabh mentioned, some might be taking a greater share of that growing pie, but it's much better to be in an industry, in an economy where the pie itself is growing. I think to the extent that, you know, the fuel banking system provides the fuel, and you've shared the data, but I think just from an international bank perspective, I think, you know, perhaps it is not registered, and therefore I should use this opportunity to share that a significant share of cross-border trade, for example, right? I mean, that is growth, that is core growth when you're exporting out or importing from somewhere else. You will find international banks having a market share which is way, way above that of many, many local, much larger players. If similarly, if you look at one of the big drivers of investment and growth in the economy going back quite some time has been, for example, FDI, you will find that international banks will play a role there. So each one will choose the segment. It's very difficult for a bank like ours to say we will do rural banking, for example. You know, the nearest rural area is 500 kilometers from our branch or so. So I think there is a significant opportunity for us. I think even as international banks, I think all of us are at least, you know, very conscious of the role we need to play, not just to operate in a bubble, but to do a real job in a real economy, help real customers export more, import more, buy more houses, or take unsecured loans. And to the point that was made by Amitabh, I think, especially for international banks, all the external developments are uniquely favorable, right? I mean, we've not had, for right reasons, wrong reasons, I don't want to get into, but we've not had an as extensive a branch network. But now with the technology available, actually you can access a lot more. I think in the previous session, somebody spoke about account aggregator. For a bank like ours, that gives you potentially access to 1 billion people, which there is zero chance we would have ever had. Now, How many of that billion we want to tap is a different matter, but the opportunities available. Or all the small companies that are part of GSTN network, and now that GSTN is a part of the, you know, it's a FIP in the AA network. Again, I think the opportunities that are opening up, the kind of growth narrative that India presents. I mean, I just went to present to our global board just 2 weeks back, and the kind of excitement that is there about the country with global, you know, senior stakeholders who can make significant influence. I think the private sector, including the broadly defined private sector, my sense is will play a much greater role, let's say next 10, 15, 20 years than might have been the case in the last 10, 15, 20 years.
Thank you. So let's hear another foreign bank, Ashu.
Yeah, so I think obviously Amitabh and Hitendra make some good points. What I'd like to say, Tamal, is I think the opportunity which the Indian economy has for growth is unprecedented. I think with that, the capital requirements which India needs, so if, for example, Citi Research estimates that in this decade, we need $350 billion of foreign capital to meet India's growth aspirations because our domestic savings have a shortfall. And I think, therefore, the question is not about private banks gaining share versus public sector. I think the pie is so big, as Hitendra mentioned, the needs are so large for the potential Indian economy has. This is about everybody and more. Frankly, if you have to get the opportunity, I think public sectors have a role to play, and I very respectfully am very mindful to some of the constraints which you mentioned to they work against, work under. I think as international banks, I think for us it's about where do we add the most value in a sustainable basis. And I think the reason, again, our CEO decided to exit consumer banking in 14 markets, not India, was purely because the view was we're going to focus on areas where we add long-term competitive value to our customers. And that for us is the institutional framework, whether it's in getting foreign capital in, FDI, a lot of work happening around PLIs, around the foreign portfolio money, whether it's equity or debt money, helping out on the digitization front, where we believe, you know, getting some of the global lens to issues like ESG, which are really relevant, CBDCs. So sharing some of those global lenses. So this is, to me, a very additive game. This is not 1+1. You know, if I eat, Amitabh doesn't eat. We are obviously competing, but it's all, India's needs are so immense. We need more of us and some more again.
Sir, IDBI,
thank you. Yeah, first of all, you know, as you have rightly said, that India is poised to become that 5 trillion economy. As per IMF estimates, by 2027, it will become 5 trillion economy. Now, the important factor is that, you know, the bank's share in non-financial private sector here in India is around 52%, whereas in, you know, the emerging economies, it is around 110%, and in the advanced economies, around 85%. So that, as Mr. Ashok Khullar said, you know, there is, you know, lot of scope is there. So for the development of all the banks, and all the banks, in fact, really can contribute for the development of the Indian economy. Now here, of course, you know, the public sector banks have certain advantages. They have very good reach, and you know, they have done excellent job in financial inclusion also. But at the same time, of course, private banks also have some advantages because they can adopt technology, can take quick decisions, and with all those, and, you know, working out on various products in a proactive manner. So that helps in increasing the market share, and that is how, during the last decade, if you have seen, private banks have been able to increase their market share by almost doubling it in last decade. But the important point now today is, like, you know, how both public sector banks and private sector banks can work together to make this dream fulfill and work with the interlinkages so that before 2027 itself, we can become 5 trillion economy. So it is working with interlinkages that is more important, whether private banks or public sector.
Okay, finally, Vaidyanathan, sir.
First of all, since Ashu spoke before me and he alluded to leading the country, I'm telling you, I'm deeply, deeply disappointed with Citi leaving India. This is such a beautiful country. With such
it's
amazing,
not Citi leaving India.
Yeah, okay, Citi Consumer Banking leaving in India, but even that's a big deal. And it's so disappointing, I can't tell you. This is such a beautiful country. Economy is growing so well. There is rule of law. There is democracy. It's just so fantastic. So, I mean, I think they'll probably come back to regret it 20 years from now when we'll probably be a you know, maybe a $10 or $15 trillion economy. But I say Amitabh did a great job in picking it up. So with that opening comment, I must say about a little bit about the thing is that of late I'm just seeing even private sector bank doing public sector bank doing a great job actually of late with the way you talk to the CEOs and all that. There is a big difference. But coming back to the context of this discussion, see, when you look ahead, let me say just 2030, we are talking of India's economy being something like about $6.75 trillion to $7 trillion. Now, I'll give you one data point, if that just helps you, and then we can extrapolate it. Just the consumer credit market of the country, just retail credit, which is home loans, car loans, all that, that is right now about 44 lakh crores as of March 22. As we speak, probably 50 lakh crores. Now, this number, which is about $600 billion, this will be about $1.5 trillion in 2030. That's a 3x number. Now, just think about it, how massive that story is, $1.5 trillion consumer credit market 2030. Now, extrapolate the story for mutual funds. Again, it's doubling or tripling. You extrapolate this for insurance companies. If you look about the IT sector, about $250 billion, and you know now that's also compounding, number of employees, you know, all that. So basically, the point is that this is a very massive game coming up. And as the private sector, undoubtedly, Tamal, like you pointed out, has a significant role to play, has a significant responsibility. And that responsibility is not only in offering high-end services like wealth management, et cetera, which we should do, but also taking credit more and more to the bottom of the pyramid and to use the ecosystem that's developing the country, all the OCEN and ONDC and AA and all that stuff. How to use that ecosystem to take credit down will be a very monumental shift in the country as we look forward in 2030.
Thank you, Vaidya. You don't mind me calling Vaidya, right? So that's a preliminary remark. Now let's get into some micro issues, and then we'll of course take questions. And since you expressed your disappointment with Citi's exit from the consumer banking, so I think Ashu should come and say that. Know how Citi, what's the way forward for Citi in India?
I think, listen, we completed 120 years in the country last week. Yeah. And I hope we should be here another 120 years at least, Vaidya.
I think the passion came for you because you started your career in Citi.
He's an ex-city.
Yeah. I wish I could shake the bosses out there and say, what are you doing, really?
No, listen, I just think the emotion which I get every day, yeah. It just shows how much people loved our consumer businesses. And
You started your career at Citi, right? And you were picked up from Bit Misra, right?
Okay.
That's your first career, yeah.
But just coming back, I think, to the question you asked, Tamal, I think, like I explained...
How you stay relevant here? Because you are... No, that Citi never sleeps. It's more into consumer banking than into anything. You brought ATM to India. And I'm sure you have a big, big plan for the corporate segment, and that's it. So you tell us, take us through.
Yeah, see, the consumer business by its very nature is the more visible just because of the brand it's dealing with consumers. Okay. Having said that, our institutional business even today is 3/4 of our business in India, which means consumer business relatively is, even from a revenue perspective, a small percentage of a business, let's say 1/4, and in terms of profitability, you'd say it's even lower, right? So I think if I give you some statistics, Citi today handles 8% of India's trade volumes. We handle 4.5% of domestic online digital payments. We handle 50% of cross-border digital payments. 30% of foreign multinationals in India bank with Citi. 30% of foreign portfolio institutional investors' custody assets are with Citi. We have one of the largest players in the corporate FX market with a 13% market share. We have consistently been top three, whether you look at equity, capital markets, fundraise, league tables or bonds, full-fledged investment banking presence. So I think what people, well, I guess I want to reiterate, is we already have a very dominant, and I would argue, no other foreign bank has the breadth and depth of the institutional business which we have. And what I mean by that is, Standard Chartered and HSBC, very large banks in India, but they perhaps don't have the same focus around investment banking which we have had. Similarly, a very able competitors in JP Morgan, Morgan Stanley, Bank of America obviously have a large focus on investment banking, but they're not as large on some of the corporate and commercial banking activities. So having that base, which by the way is very large, if we look at our competitive advantage, what is it which is unique about Citi today? It's our globality. We are in 120 countries, which is by far the largest network. And that network can be brought to take Indian companies who are desirous of growing abroad, whether directly by putting up operations or by export. So we take Indian companies out and we get foreign companies in. If you talk about what may be the biggest opportunity which India has today, it's about supply chain diversification from countries like China. In the last 2 weeks, I've started hearing about not only China plus one, but Europe plus one, given that Europe now increasingly, from an energy cost perspective, is becoming very harsh, high-cost economy, labor is becoming an issue. So India has a once-in-a-generation opportunity to attract. And remember what I said, for our growth aspirations, we need foreign capital. It can either come in as FDI or it comes as an FPI. FDI is great because it gets technology, jobs, manufacturing into the country. Citi is intrinsically involved right now, for example, in all the production-linked incentive schemes which the government has as a part of getting FDI into the country. 70% of the clients who have come in on the EMS, which is the first smartphone segment, have come in through Citi. So I think in terms of where our focus is, I'm very proud that our focus going forward, and which has been, is purely and directly aligned with what the government of India priorities are. Whether it's, you know, like I said, building a higher manufacturing base, attracting foreign direct investment, getting more digitization into the country, boosting MSME. One of the other things which we are doing, Tamal, we already have a very large commercial banking presence, as does Hitendra, and we are looking at really boosting that. So we've already added around 50% more bankers in our commercial banking. This is the MSME segment. Within that, where we really think we add value is either MSMEs who are desirous of increasing their exports and therefore want the value of a network, or who believe digitization is critical to their operating efficiency increasing. That India is among the three countries globally which has been identified to a major ramp up in that business. Okay? Of course, building APIs, a lot of the trends in the market today are customers trying to sell directly to consumers. So the whole B2C, the C2B, which requires heavy investments in building smart payments capabilities, which is low value, high volume. And I think we're investing heavily in having API linkages with our clients, AI capabilities, and just having a lot of infrastructure build out on those things. So we're not going anywhere. We are already large and dominant. And I think the question is of reallocating and reshuffling capital into areas where we believe most value. Lastly, after the US now, India is the second largest employee force for Citi globally, because apart from the bank, we also have 5 service centers where we have 28,000 people. We are adding 10,000 a year.
Thanks. So you are going nowhere. Whether relax, sleep well. Now tell us about your bank's model, because he spoke about MSME, and we know what's the contribution of MSME sector does to Indian GDP. It's a huge, huge. And you are one bank who's experimenting with a different kind of business model, because IDFC, which was an infrastructure finance company, now got a banking license, and then the new avatar is different that you have reshaped. So is it correct to interpret that you are not treading the usual path of banking which others do, which is home loan and auto loan and corporate loan, but you are creating a new market, sort of an NBFC within the banking system? Is this the right way of describing IDFC Bank? Can you give us a sense?
No, well, it might have started like that, but it's no longer like that. But I'll put it better way. So our lending side of a bank, the retail side of it, started in 2010. Loan book was 94 crores. By 2018, our loan book was 30,000 crores. Today, our loan book is about 1 lakh crore. You can see that in 12 years, it has grown from zero base to 1 lakh crore. And if you now, with this number, you know where this game will head, maybe 5 years from now, 2 lakh crore, another 5 years from now, maybe 4 lakh crore, 10 lakh crore. This game is not going to stop at all, according to me. It certainly, in my opinion, will outlive me. Why that is so is that, one, we know about India, all that, doing well. But in our case, we have a deep specialization in doing retail lending. Deep meaning that our gross NPA has never crossed 2%, and our net NPA has never crossed 1%, except in COVID. Like 12 years, a long track record. So therefore, we believe that our ability to do this space in a safe and stable manner with low NPA, low credit cost, is a very unique advantage in the Indian context. Now, the very important thing is the liability base that we got now. Because now, see, frankly, it's a point of view. Because for us, if our cost of funds is 5.5, well, I'd say it's fantastic because we're used to borrowing at maybe 7 or 8 or 9. If you ask Amitabh to borrow at 5.5, he'll scratch his head and say, man, it's too high. Because the fundamental constructs of how these two institutions are created are different. But in a bank license, we feel there is an evergreen source of funds for liabilities. Assets is already fantastic. So we believe this game can't be stopped. The only thing we have to watch out for all the time is that we've got to constantly stay on the cutting edge of technology, and we've got to maintain high levels of corporate governance. After that, this game's pretty much a long-term story.
Thank you, Mr. Dave, sir. I'll hear you. We heard Citi. Now we hear HSBC, how you approach the Indian market and contributing to Indian growth story. So historically, if you see, I can't think of any foreign bank which has successfully negotiated the path of retail lending. I mean, I can give any names. Look at Barclays, with so much of fanfare it started. But it's difficult. It's not cost effective. The kind of investment you need to know, and the Indian psyche, and everything is so different and all. So none of the foreign banks has succeeded in tapping the retail market. Even though if you look at the entire banking sector, in a macro level, probably it's now 50-50, between retail and corporate and all. So what is the positioning of HSBC, if you can take us through, and what kind of role we can expect HSBC, because you're not a listed entity here, so if there are investors, you can't pick up things that buying HSBC stock you have to do elsewhere, not in India. But from the Indian economic point of view, as borrower and lenders, like as a savers, I don't see you are giving me the kind of enticing interest rates which the local banks are given. We drive down on the Indian the Western Express Highway. I was counting from airport to Bandra. I found 17 hoardings by banks talking about interest rate. This many days, this much percent. It's very unusual when I have seen, and I may have missed something, but 17 at least I saw. I'm talking about a few days back. So, but HSBC, no. 7%, 8%, 8.5%. I don't know whether you even give 6.5%.
No, give us a sense. Let me just, first, before yes. I answer the question. The first ATM in the country was from HSBC. Everything else Citi did, but this one we did. Okay. Just for the record, okay? So, I think all of us have to play to, this is our thinking, right, wrong, time will tell, that we have to play to the segment that wants a bank like ours, right? I mean, so who are we a banker to in retail, right? I mean, anybody in the audience, anybody out there, you would typically want a bank with a bank like us. If you typically either are of a certain level of affluence or income or whatever. Second, if you have international needs, almost everybody or lots of people are sending their kids abroad to study. You'd be surprised at the number of calls that come to me only for this. That time they don't ask me what is my deposit rate, right? They just ask me, can my child's account be opened in Canada or Australia or US or wherever? And you'd be surprised at how much people are willing to pay for that service. I think the third thing is we are not a rates-led, every organization has their own strategy and it works for them. Ours is a very service-oriented model. I think you should expect better quality service from us. So if we fail on that count, then we get very heavily penalized by the customer because you're not paying the rates and then you're not delivering the service also, right? So it's a bad, bad outcome. But otherwise, I think given what we spoke about Citi's decision strategically, clearly, there is a market out there, and India is becoming more and more affluent each passing week, right? I mean, the number of customers who would have wanted to bank with a bank like ours, I would say 3 years back to now, would have more than tripled just through the income effect and the wealth effect, et cetera. So I think we want to be a bank that caters to affluent Indians with international aspirations. On the asset side, like I mentioned earlier, it was difficult to compete. Banks like Axis, banks like IDFC, banks like SBI just do such a phenomenally good job, you know, loans in 5 seconds, this in 20 seconds, this in 30 seconds. When I go to my head office and say, I want to approve a loan in 5 seconds, they really want to get my head examined that, have you got it right? This is money we are giving out, right? So it's a very different market India is versus the rest of the world. But the changes, like I mentioned, right? The fact that now I can tell the customer who's a customer of, let's say, any of the banks that my rates, not are we, by the way, if we are lowest on the deposit side, we also tend to be lowest on the asset side.
By the way, watch out, huh? Your affluent customers will come to me now very soon. Good sure. rates, no fees, yes. and good service. So, Hitendra, you have really something to really consider for you.
Sure. No, see, competition is always good. Competition is always welcome because it makes us the best out of all of us. But what I'm saying is on the liability side, wealth side, proposition side, I think we are sorted. Where we were not sorted was on the asset side. Developments, which HSBC hasn't really contributed to but can really tap into, have opened up, and hopefully you will see us more and more in that space. If we will advertise a rate, it will be that we will be typically the lowest price lender for individual borrowers.
You do some work also, a lot of work in the financial inclusion space also, right? Yes. Am I correct?
No. So we have almost 15 years back decided to work very closely. It's a, you know, we don't talk about it much, but otherwise in the microfinance space, not only through the lending book, which we have a very large book on, but also through supporting them through community efforts, through sharing technology, sharing best practices, etc. It's a very large area of commitment and interest to us. Just, I know the question is on retail, but I think even startups is a very large segment for us. We possibly bank sure. more startups than maybe perhaps many, many locally large banks also. So there is space for everybody is my point.
Lighter comment, don't take it seriously.
You know, Everything is on a lighter note, sir.
Vaidya is in a mood today. I mean, he's Citibank on HSBC. So let's, Sharma sahab, just tell you have been doing a phenomenal job. I'm just going through the number. Your provision coverage ratio is 97.86%, 98%. I think you're the highest provision coverage ratio among all the banks. I don't need to explain what is provision coverage ratio because there's a literate audience. Yes, your gross non-performing assets is pretty high, 16.51, but because you have so much of provision, et cetera, you have done, net NPA is just 1.15%. And of course, you are back to profit in a big way and all. So tell us about what is happening? What is the new IDBI emerging now?
So who thank you.
Well, how much the government will control or will be board driven or what? I mean, as an investor, as a depositor, and as I said, for the growth story of India, where is our IDBI positioned? IDBI Bank, the new IDBI Bank, which we'll get to know very soon.
So thank you very much. Now, first of all, like, you know, these financial indicators, whatever you have also told, these are all in public. So everybody knows about that. But I will like to say something about the non-financial things also. Like, you know, after coming here, so
we have some secrets which are not in public domain so that you get it on. Tell us some secrets which are not in public domain.
Not in public domain. So like, you know, the underwriting practices, risk management policies, which we have revised. And now, in fact, the own staff morale part, then, you know, the rating part, assessment part, what we, you know, we have done a lot of changes on corporate governance and inter-office, that accounting officer area. So a lot of improvement has been done. So now the cleaning part, both financially and non-financially, it is, you know, quite good work has been done. Now, coming to the financial indicator, as you have rightly indicated, now, you know, everybody tells me about the gross NPA. This, of course, is eyesore for me also. But, of course, we know that, you know, the because my provision coverage ratio is almost 97% for that. 97. So this also we will take care. So, but more important is that net NPA has been brought down to 1.15. Now, what we have done, like from the large credit-focused bank, we have converted this bank into the retail bank. both liability side as well as the asset side. Now my CASA ratio stands at 56%. It's one of the highest in the industry. And then similarly in retail, the advances part, it is 63%, 67% is retail. So like this, both retail work in MSME, agriculture, this we have done, good job. And provision coverage, the bank is giving, the net interest margin, NIM of more than 4%. And the cost of deposits, cost of, these funds, this has been reduced drastically. So all this work. So what my focus is that when the new investor comes, they should find value in the bank. That is what we are trying to create value in the bank. So with all this, I think the investor will find it a good, interesting proposition to buy. How the disinvestment will be done, that will be handled by Deepam. So they are doing the process, and it may take about a year's time, or before that also it can be done. But during this period, the focus will be on performance, so that we can further improve it and create value for the government and the stakeholders.
Vida, you are keeping quiet. Anything you want to say on him?
No, I think he's doing a great job and dressed it up perfectly. I think it's a good bride.
Dressed it up?
It's a good bride. So it's a good acquisition.
look.
This is not window dressing. This is not dressing.
No, I'm not doing window dressing. I'm saying he's just dressed up well. Okay. Of course, he's also done it well internally. So absolutely, of course.
Okay. Okay, you're in a good mood. So you have so much of provision you have made, which means as and when you recover the money, it adds to your bottom line, right?
Yeah, right. In fact, if you see by this 97 point, that provision coverage ratio is on NPA. If you include the provisions which we have done on standard assets, then the provision coverage ratio becomes 111%. The provision, standard assets add against 0.25, we have almost 4% of provisions on standard assets.
And 56% is your CASA.
56%.
That probably the highest ever? Highest among the banks?
No, it is, I think, Maharashtra Bank, Bank of Maharashtra, and Kotak Bank.
Kotak Bank.
These two
what
banks.
What about yours, Vaidya? 50%. Okay.
So these two banks, sir, are slightly higher.
So all of us keen to hear you because you are big, but not as big as HDFC and ICICI, even though you started the same way. And now with the acquisition, it's getting, the process is getting completed. With Citibank's consumer financing, can you take us through what would be the new avatar of Axis Bank?
So let me.
And after this, after Amitabh speaks, no hurry. You take your own time, because there are many investors also here who would like to hear you. Of course, the savers who keep money and the borrowers. We'll take a few questions. So please keep the microphone ready, please, both sides. Yeah, sir.
Thank you, Tamal. Let me just make one kind of macro comment and then build it up from there. Frankly, when you look at the financial services industry and most of the industries in India, it doesn't apply to just the financial services. There are only in every industry 5 to 6 players who can provide end-to-end full depth of services. We are one of them. And frankly, when I heard my colleagues, and they're all very right, they have been forced over a period of time to decide which customer segments and markets they want to play in. Ashu said, decided to get out of retail, I'll do corporate, I do global very well. He then talked about the segment thereafter. Vaidya talked about, I'm going into retail in a big way, I don't want to touch wholesale. It is happening because to really compete and provide a full service, be a full service bank to customers of India or Indians, you need to be of a certain size. And we are, happen to be of that size. And what will happen is, as the market moves towards a 5 trillion economy, we are not going to just sit here with our size and say, yes, you keep your niche and we'll not touch it. We will come after them in their niches also. I'm not trying to, tell them, but it is a natural course of things that if we find that they're making too much money in their natural, their niche areas, we will attack that too, as fintechs are attacking us. So it's the same way it works. So we believe that in Axis, we have created a platform which allows us to cater to demands and requests and desires of all Indians. And we need to continue to build on this platform. So that's one. Second, unlike a lot of the countries around the world, Indian government, I think, has been at the forefront, Indian government and RBI, in creating publicly available free platforms which can be used to disintermediate markets or reach customers in very different ways than before. And there are enough of them, but I don't need to repeat it for everyone. Now, that combined with expectations of RBI on resilience, customer conduct, governance, add to that the technology requirements, add to that the cybersecurity issues, add to that the kind of frauds which are taking place. If you want to play that game, you need a huge amount of capability to spend that kind of money and be in that game. So the second part, what we're trying to do in Axis is to, again, use this platform to play across all these opportunities which are going to open up as part of this $5 trillion economy. And third is, we have put a line in the sand and said there are three things we're going after. Apart from the typical things which a bank would do, we said we are going to become the Bharat Bank of the Bharat. We have said that we are going after customer service as a big area of focus, and we have defined a certain NPS score we want to go after, and we have said that we want to create a digital bank within a digital bank. I know everyone has given statistics. I'll just leave only one statistic on the table here. Our mobile app today of Axis Bank is the best rated app in the world in mobile apps. We have reached that level. Its rating on Google Play Store is 4.8, and this is compared to 60 global banks, various fintech banks, and so on and so forth. Reaching 4.8 has been a journey for us. So we can create global standards sitting in India, serving Indians. And we have demonstrated that. So we are going after these three things. There is obviously a huge amount of work which has gone into ensuring that we understand what we are talking about, what the scoping of this kind of line in the sand is, and how we go after it. These are all long-term projects. We believe we can get them right. We can execute on them right. Axis Bank will look even more different and more better than what it is today. And that's the journey we are on. As you will see, we have recently launched the ads in the newspapers on our completely globally benchmark wholesale banking products platform. So yes, in that we'll compete with Citi and try to go to their customers and say we have a great platform we should use. And Ashu is absolutely right. They are a global bank, so is HSBC. But when some of these customers follow the China plus one and the Euro plus one strategy, and their operations in India become large enough, when they become more Indianized, they will have to work with people like us and work in a very significant manner, and will have to use the platforms we are creating. So we are hoping they'll do a good job of bringing them in to India, and at some stage we'll take it over from them and take the baton like we've taken the baton on retail bank. Hopefully at that time we don't have to pay a price for it. We'll get it, we'll work hard and get it for free. But that's the journey we are on, and we are quite hopeful that India is, as I think very rightly said, uniquely placed. All the kind of stars are aligning together. I hope we can execute well as a country on all these stars aligning together. And if we can, I think the next 10, 15 years could potentially be great for India, unless some global macro plays out differently.
Thanks. We'll take questions. Before that, anything you want to say? Oh, Amitabh, so you'll not say anything. Come on.
I can clearly see Amitabh is going after everybody. But I can tell you that I can only talk for ourselves. I can safely say that we're feeling very strong from within our, and we're feeling like if you talk to any employee of IDFC First Bank today, you'll generally see a buzz in them. They'll all be very happy, motivated, energetic. They're feeling they have fantastic products to sell. And short point is that, that my opinion, this retail loan book of 1 lakh crore will not stay at 1 lakh crore. Can keep growing, it can become 25%, every 2-3 years, you can see that this bank will be very a new bank altogether.
But his mobile app got 4.6 from Google, is the best in the world.
Well, there is something for us to aspire for, but I think we are on a set on a good platform. Yeah.
Okay, good luck. Any question anybody has? No grievance redressal. It's not a grievance redressal forum. So ask, stick to policy and macro, okay? Please. Very quick, no observation, just question.
Thank you, Tamal. First of all, a great panel and a lot of enlightenment to hear the great speakers. My name is Sandeep Sharma. I come from two institutions which is represented by Vaidya, which is ICICI Bank and with HDFC Standard Life. So it's a great pleasure. So my question is, while we are talking about lending, reaching the heights, but the good lending institution is not one with, a spending power, but actually with collection power. How good is the collection system? Lending can be done by, in 5 minutes, 1 second. Tamal, you started the discussion with the governor having great, collection of ties. One can make underwriting out of that.
No, I got that. I'll take your question. Sure. Keep it simple. So basically, it's not even collection power. That concept of having collection power is so outdated. It is about underwriting in such a way that you have very limited amount of collections to do physically. So I'll give you one important thing. So with the amount of digitization that has happened, digital ecosystem open India, not digitization by banks, digital ecosystem opening in India, let me tell you, you're underwriting loans. Underwriting loans earlier, we were taking physical paper from customers. All of us do that 5-10 years ago. Now, bank statement is coming. You're reading a bank statement and you're analyzing the information, taking a lending. Now, in terms of collections, earlier you'd send an agent to the customer's place. Now we're sending UPI link. And when they're sending UPI link, customer's paying you with UPI. Now, all of you remember how credit cards were paid. You used to have a post boxes outside the branches, and people used to come and leave a checkbook in that checkbox. You don't do that anymore. Customers coming to the. So the point is that it is not necessary to have, it is basically whole process of KYC, customer identification has become digital, fraud evaluation has become digital, underwriting has become digital, operations has become digital, disbursal has become digital, monitoring has become digital, collections become digital. So this is a very big factor happening, and that I think you should keep that picture in mind.
Okay, any other question? This gentleman, yeah, please. No, you need a microphone. Can you have the microphone? Just make it brief, please. Huh? Introduce yourself. No comment, just the question. Because we have just about 10 minutes, less than 10 minutes, and we need to have one more round. Yeah.
Sir, I come from the startup world, and extremely energizing session. Thank you. There's a popular joke about every fintech CEO dreaming of becoming a bank and every bank CEO dreaming of a working app. So the fintech space is heating up and you're facing competition from neobanks that are emerging and are catering to more savvy and younger customer bases. What is your take on competition between traditional private banks and emerging neobanks in the country now?
Who wants to take the question? Amit.
So firstly, you're absolutely right that I think what I'm aware of is about 9-10 neobanks or people calling themselves or thinking of themselves as neobanks who have come to the market over the last 18 to 24 months. But I think now RBI has come out with a clear policy which says that you can't be a quasi-bank. If you want to be a proper bank, then come through the front door. And if you don't want to come through the front door, you want to remain outside the door and behave like a bank, then there are certain rules around it. You have to work with a bank inside to behave like even a quasi-bank. I would say that competition is real. They will keep innovating. They will like to innovate outside this room so that the rules don't apply to them. The regulator at some stage will come in and try to ensure that the depositor's interest and the customer interest is taken care of. Because there is a huge cost to ensure that the customer conduct is proper, which all of us are doing in some form or shape because you're governed by RBI. But so my view is that we will keep improving ourselves to compete with you. We will partner with you in many cases because you will have no choice and we'll have no choice. And in third, some of us will take some stake in you to ensure that we can benefit from all the great work you guys are doing. It is ultimately a model which will evolve. Right now, you will see that the acquisitions of most of the new banks have gone down because they have to pivot their model again to the new requirements. And as even one of them keeps making a mistake or doing the wrong thing or customer conduct going wrong, new rules will come which will impose things on all the banks, which will create a problem. So I think the partnership is the best way to go. I'm hoping some of the new banks are hoping to get a license finally. Welcome to the room. And you'll enjoy when you come to the room. We're looking forward to that.
Thanks, Santavya.
The other thing is that the new big thing actually in town is actually doing embedded banking because the customers are naturally flowing into, let me say, e-com company. You go and plug themselves there. But the issue that I think with regard to this fintech thing, is actually two sides. One is on the lending side, frankly, things are broadly okay. The issue is broadly on the liability side. If you're allowing technology firms or maybe technology fintech firms, so to say, to open accounts for you, just remember the question that is often a conflict is that subsequently, whose customer is it? Who's going to touch the customer after that in terms of continuous relationship management? Who's going to sell the next mutual fund to the customer? Who's going to sell the next insurance product to the customer? If the customer has to see a bank statement of account, will they come to the fintech's app or they're going to come to the bank's app? Now, what about data? For example, if the data leaks from that layer and that fintech sells some of the products to the customer which banks are not permitted to sell, then you are sitting in a conflict because regulators always catching the bank and saying, hello, you're responsible for this. Now the data can leak from that end to sell. So then the customer service, So customer service, if the layer is not providing good service, customer comes here or customer goes to the fintech. So these are the sort of conflicts to be sorted out and to have a more long-lasting relationship. Honestly, I believe this issue about who handles service, who handles operations, who handles that issue and data privacy issues have not been sorted yet.
Thanks, Veda. We have about 5 minutes left. Yeah. So just one, maybe two sentences each from each of you, starting from you and ending with Amitabh, because Amitabh, you started. We have been throughout the day, right from the government governor session to the public-private bank session. We have been discussing the current scenario in banking, high credit growth, relatively low deposit growth. Actually, banking is more about managing liability than assets. The prudent banker says that. This gentleman asked about collection. I would say more important collection, more important than collection is actually liability business. So starting with you, how do you, just quick two sentences each, there is a saving community here. What is the way forward? Do you think your banking system needs to pay off more to the depositors, to garner deposit to support the credit growth, or they will rein in the credit growth? Or some of them probably will go to the market and raise capital, that's also another way, or tier one, tier two, both, and then liquidating excess government holdings. There are multiple possibilities. So how the new landscape at this point of time folding up? Just 30 seconds each.
Yes, very quick one. No doubt when credit is growing fast and like the governor said, there is underlying productive demand for credit. Now, on the liability side, it can come from three sources. Number one, banks can, of course, some of them will raise bonds, maybe, and fund themselves. Could be, of course, equity also. But on the liability side, once the interest rates are rising, then automatically the deposits of the Indian system will grow. Why does it happen? When you do that, then from alternative sources of credit, let me say people are keeping money in liquid mutual funds. Now they'll move the money to a bank if interest rates are attractive. So, therefore, in other words, raising money through bonds and borrowings is definitely an option open, which will happen for sure. And number two, with raising or rising of interest rates, the deposit market will grow. Eventually, equilibrium will be found. I believe within this end of this year itself, because all banks are, let me say, at least on the fixed deposit side, all banks are raising interest rates, it will raise the deposit market.
Yeah, like from my bank of point of view, I'll say that, you know, earlier for the last 3-4 years, we were not lending much, only retail we were doing. So that way liquidity was very comfortable. In fact, that was my problem. So now with, you know, better management of liquidity, rather we are able to optimize upon the funds. So that way liquidity and capital both now are quite okay. And it's, you know, we have been able to manage our asset liability in a better way.
Ashu, any observation, even though it's not strictly relevant because you are exiting consumer market, still?
I think the only thing I'd say is our institutional business is actually very well funded. So we were not dependent on consumer business for a deposit. But I think the way we should also look at deposits is if you can get it by servicing a customer's need as a part of the normal way cash management and add value, then you get liabilities at a much lower cost, which I know all of us, that's holy grail. But I think that's a lot of focus for us to invest in technologies to do that.
Dave, sir.
No, I think my sense is the credit growth we are experiencing is a bit structural. Okay, that's because a new borrower is now found to be credit worthy, which we couldn't find earlier. So there is an increase in the borrower base, both in the business side, SME, MSME, as well as on the individual side. Plus, I think the NBFC sector relative to banks has shrunk a little bit. I'm just saying in the last 5 years. And the third is, in a rising rate scenario, naturally mutual funds who also compete with you for lending, obviously they're, you know, they get withdrawal from their debt fund. So I think as a banking industry, I think I think this is a multi-year runway. It's not a 1 or 2 year growth thing. And therefore, to your point, all managements and all ALCOs, et cetera, I think will need to spend a lot more time on liabilities. And because the asset thing is maybe much more BAU now, but liability, after many years, we'll have to start fighting for and competing for. Yeah.
Amitabh, sir, is it the first time you are seeing this scrapping for fighting for liability in your entire career? Have you ever seen this kind of thing?
My new career in banking, yes, of course. I was a banker a long time back.
Yeah.
But yes, there is a clear scramble for liabilities. And as you said, you notice it on the notice boards, you see it every day in terms of the conversations which are happening, the bidding which is happening for some of the corporate deposits. It's all very obvious. And as you rightly pointed out, as a wise banker said, everything starts with liabilities. Without that, you can't think of all this great asset growth. I completely agree with Hitendra that based on what we see today, it looks like the runway for credit growth is huge and long. And if the deposits growth do not catch up, at some stage, the credit growth will get impacted. It's not a magic. Credit growth has to be a subset of deposit growth. It can't be the other way around. So at some stage, yes, all of us have to work harder on deposits. Yes, all of us are trying to sweat our franchise more in terms of firstly ensuring that we don't have excess liquidity sitting in the wrong parts of the balance sheet. But we have to scramble, work harder for deposits. And that's why if you look at strategies of each of the banks, all of us, in some way or shape, we are trying to attack the liability side of the balance sheet very meaningfully. We might not be talking about it, but all of us are working on it.
Thank you.
About many of the existing banks, let me say ICICI, HDFC, Axis, and all these banks, they've been here for, say, 18, 20 years or 30 years, and therefore they have the whole ecosystem tied up in terms of the chain of the liability system, whether stock market or whatever. So let me say the newer banks, so to say, are focusing more on new to bank deposits who are coming in, who are new customers coming in with deposits. Vis-a-vis existing banks are, of course, dealing with existing customers, raising their balances. But let me just say that, you know, banks like ours, let me say I talk of our bank, we're finding that we have given fairly attractive interest rates, but more than that, we've withdrawn fees. I don't know, you might have seen an ad a couple of days ago where we completely zeroed fees on all services on the liability side, literally all zero. Whether IMPS, RTGS, check the cash deposit at branches, cash withdrawal at branches, you name the stuff, they're all gone. So we believe that these are really strong and powerful points for customers to bring deposits to us.
Amitabh sir, want to say anything? How he was marketing his bank sitting here?
Don't ask, very aggressive guy here. He already acquired Citi. He wants to acquire
HSBC. Our name speaks for
now.
Itself. People talked about Citi acquisition. They said how great a franchise you're taking over. They have talked enough about Axis already while they're marketing themselves. Okay, no problem.
Okay. I mean, and why do you need Amitabh Bachchan? Yourself can do all this. I mean, you don't need Bachchan's have to. Okay. With this happy note, so as you see that everybody is geared up on our extreme left. Amitabh Chaudhary, it's a new Axis, bigger, bolder, with different kind of business model where everything is almost built in. You have Mr. Dave, he spoke about how he focuses on India and diaspora and their children, their education, everything in different parts of the world. That's how he is growing, so he does not need to build this kind of liability franchise you need. You heard Citibank, which is in the process of giving up its consumer banking, but focusing in a big way, cross-border lending and everything, including MSME and, of course, corporate India. You have heard IDBI, the new avatar, which is reading to be privatized. And finally, Vaidyanathan, we have already spoken. I'm not doing any marketing for you. So I think we have an entertaining session. And so the consensus is this: India's public sector banks, including foreign, old, and the new, they are ready to face the challenges of the kind of credit demand it's coming. And they are ready to push India to the next orbit, they will call it 5 trillion or whatever it is, as and when that happened, few years down the line. We are already the fifth largest economy in the world. And if you look at multilateral agencies' reports, everybody, now India is the story, India is the place, everything is happening, be it digitization or in the financial sector. And one of the reasons of so much of optimism about India is this: Indian financial sector is extremely resilient. The worst is behind, and it is ready to support the growth story. So with that, we end. Thank you, gentlemen. And if you have liked it, then please give them a big hand. They deserve it. Thank you.